How's everyone doing? Good. I'd like to take this opportunity to talk about Bodhi Mind. Which is the foundation of the Mahayana tradition. Within which Chan is grounded in. I say Bodhi Mind is the foundation of Mahayana because it appears in, at least textually, it appears in the earliest evidence of Mahayana scriptures, that is the Prajnaparamita genre of text. The, what is called the perfection of wisdom. It is that which distinguishes earlier teachings. Even though it's distinguished from the early teachings, it is not separate. It's grounded. Bodhi mind. Bodhi means awakening. Mind, heart, citta. Bodhi mind in Sanskrit is bodhicitta. There are distinct qualities of bodhicitta. Many ways to talk about this, but two distinct qualities, irrespective of different interpretations, different from different Mahayana traditions. It has these two qualities. One, an aspiration to full awakening to Buddhahood. Second, this aspiration is rooted in compassion for all beings. So, we have the first distinct quality of the Mahayana tradition as bodhicitta, the union of wisdom and compassion. When I say it is this wisdom, aspiration for this wisdom, rooted in compassion, this compassion is not an abstract ideal. It's rooted in experience. So, for most people, we operate out of a self-concern. Self-referential tendencies, perspectives, views, which is absolutely normal and it's necessary as the foundation of practice. Because the positive attributes of this kind of self-referential experiencing of the world validates the basic need for self-care, integrity, congruence. Right? So this is the wholesome aspect of a healthy, strong sense of self. self-care, take care of ourselves. Integrity, right? And congruence. Integrity here means one is whole, grounded. The self is cultivated to be virtuous, right? Wholesome. And congruence refers to an alignment of body, speech, and mind. So how we feel inside is embodied, expressed out through our actions and verbally. There's no concealment. There's honesty. So this becomes the necessary foundation of practice. So the sense of self, when it's cultivated, this is the way to go, in other words. We cultivate a sense of integrity, self-care, and congruence. And when we respond in this way, there's great energy in it, and there's passion. There's passion in what we do, that our endeavors, and the way we love self and others. It's congruent. It brings about many aspects of virtue, such as knowing how we actually feel, our heart, and as a foundation, we will be able to sense how other people may feel. So we become very in tune with our embodied experiencing. This gets back to the congruence part. But Buddha Dharma does not stop there. So this is the foundation. Many of us are still in the process of kind of cultivating these aspects. So the self must be solid, grounded, connected, congruent. But we must go further. As we practice more, becoming more in tune, especially with our body, with how we feel, we become more sensitized, not only to ourselves. Our heart and mind become more refined. We become more sensitized to those people around us, more sensitized to not only in the way that we're connected to ourselves, but the way we are connected to others. That's why I say bodhicitta is grounded in experience, grounded in practice. And experiencing this connectedness with others is able to further this healthy, strong sense of self. It's able to avoid the negative side of the self-referential experiencing. What are the negative sides? Yes, we have passion in what we do, how we feel, we're connected to the body, we have a sense of integrity, self-integrity, congruence. But the negative side of this is the sense of control of circumstances around us. So the other side of self-validation is this validating our view of things, our perspective of things. So the world is experienced in a self-referential way. Right? And the only real way that's going to pull us out of this self-referential tendency with the negative attributes of wanting to control things the way that you think is best, your perspective on things, is through this connection with ourselves, we become connected, recognizing the connection that we have with others. All that we are, the good qualities and the not so good qualities, comes from our connection with others. So beginning to recognize that everything that we have, possess, everything that we are, is actually connected to all the experiences that we have with other people. Even negative experiences in the past has brought us, for example, many people I see, negative relationships and life experiences has brought them to the Buddha Dharma. Right? So we should be grateful to them, or shaped us in a certain way that forced us to draw out the resources that we have inside, to face challenges, to face difficulties. So in other sense, we're able to recognize that everything, all of our experiences in the past, is able to encompass everyone in our lives, distant and far, and near, close, even those people we're not familiar with. We don't even know. We may have read something from this person or studied it in school. So we are, whether we like it or not, we're embodying all of humanity and all the actions from humanity. So the sense of self moves from self-referential to for lack of a better term, big expanded sense of self. And there are many shades of this kind of a big sense of self. Activists, for example, they work for the betterment of humanity. Right. And that's a kind of big self. Right. So they make sacrifices, accommodations, and their concerns for the welfare. So that's a kind of positive attributes of this big self from a secular perspective. And but very often, if you examine this kind of big sense of self, even encompassing humanity for the betterment, for the progress, for the justice and freedom there's still a dark side to that. This big sense of self. What is this dark side? There's usually an us versus them. Right? Even for those people who values the experiences of the underprivileged, in academia, we call it the subaltern. The subaltern, the people that without voice, the people that are discriminated against, yeah. And they are hyper vigilant of microaggressions from the words and actions of people that discriminate against these people. Which is virtuous, which is wholesome. But within that, sometimes they vilify those people who do not align with these values of pluralism, valuing the voices of those unheard, underprivileged, right? So those people who are bigots, those people who are perpetrators. So even this sense of great sense of self, it could be just a sense of self expanded to your family, right? Or your country, or the whole world. For most people, it may be one political party versus another. Within that, there's this opposition still there. So even though they work for the betterment of humanity, even when they value those underprivileged, they're always culprits. It's very hard for them to accept. So in a secular sense, in the religious sense, we also see this kind of big sense of self, right? Love your neighbor, love your enemy. Except those people who oppose this view of loving your enemy. So there's the Crusades. There's a need to conquer. There's a need to convert. But the Dharma is devoid of this tendency to convert. An authentic Buddha Dharma. If you see in early scriptures, you see in later scriptures, the Buddha taught all kinds of people. He never wanted to convert anyone. People don't want to be Brahmins, they teach them how to be good Brahmins. I think people want to be good practitioners. They teach them how to be good practitioners. So this need to convert those who do not share our sense of values, however virtuous and accepting, embracing, there's that oppositional mind. And then you have this even kind of more profound or a step further from that. What is it that can pull a person out from, when I said that, what is it that can pull a person from a self-referential tendency is that sense of connection with your group, right? Others, those people around you, and broaden to humanity, right? Your actions and speech kind of begin out of there. That's the virtuous quality. The not-so-virtue is this oppositional tendency that's still lingering around in that. So what is it that pulls from this kind of big self to no self? That's the genius of bodhicitta, Bodhi mind. Embodied, connected, but not tethered, not bound by the forms and appearances of even this humanity. So this is called formless. Formless. This is a distinct feature of Bodhi mind. It is not self-referential. It is not other referential. It is formless, selfless. How to understand this formless? When there's form, there's distinctions, there's characteristics. There's your group versus that group. Right? There's this position versus that position. And there are perpetrators, there are victims. On that basis, it's not to deny that there is no victim or perpetrator. The world functions in terms of perpetrators and victims. There are people that need help. There are people that are underprivileged, suppressed, oppressed. On this basis, the cultivation of formlessness is of utmost importance. So the drive is there, the connection is there, the passion is there. But self-referential grasping to appearances, tendency to compartmentalize our narratives of this versus that, us versus them, good versus bad, having versus lacking, privilege versus underprivilege. Not so tethered to that, not so tied, bound by that. We recognize how things are, and we work for the benefit of all. In other words, suffering pervades those perpetrators, those people that inflict suffering, that oppress people. They're the first one that's suffering. Yeah. Disconnected. As they dehumanize others, they actually dehumanize their own feelings. They actually go against the grain of how they actually feel. That suffering, that kind of anguish, that kind of disconnection. So all they know is greed, aversion, jealousy, envy, suspicion. In other words, all these things having in common is the sense of control. That's all they know. So this is what drives them. This is the mark of suffering. So recognizing the problems of the world and the malaise, right, on the worldly level and also spiritual level, and work towards the betterment of all beings, including those that don't share our views, Is it possible to not take a stance, a position in the betterment of humanity? From the worldly perspective, social sciences, impossible. From the activist point of view, not possible. You have to take a stance. From the bodhisattva perspective, you may take a stance, but in taking the stance, you have no attachment. That's difficult, right? Usually our sense of identity is bound up with our attachments, bound up with positionality. Therefore, whatever actions that we take are infused with, however subtle, a sense of control, a sense of agenda. And because of that agenda, self-attachment is there. Now, the self may include all beings. I'm all for, you know, the underprivileged, for example. But because the agenda is there, positionality will be there. And attachment will be there. And there will be others. There'll be self. Self, the big self, you know, expanded to, you know, your group, right? Your religion. Your nationality. So, because of that, suffering will be perpetuated. So bodhisattva practitioners, they may take a stance. They may fight for the freedom and justice of all, for the peace of all. But they're not attached. No position, no form. And this distinction, only they will know. For practitioners of Chan, the more we practice, the more connected we are. The more connected we feel with others. And that connection does not, should not, discriminate between us versus them. I only connect to that kind of people and not that group. No. Because what grounds that connection is the Four Noble Truth, Buddha Dharma. Right? We learn to recognize suffering, vexations, klesha, you know, three poisons, greed, hatred, ignorance. And from that extends the whole host of vexations, right? The mechanism, the lubricant of suffering. So grounded in that, very sensitized to suffering, very sensitized to vexations. In other words, sensitized to the sense of self-referentiality. So when you are sensitized to that, and you encounter beings, however virtuous they may be, idealistic they may be, the sense of self that they have, very sensitive to it. It's like a thorn. When the self manifests, it's like a thorn that you see. Right? The first person that's uncomfortable is actually yourself. It's actually yourself. First person that's suffering is actually yourself. So for a person who have experienced awakening, you know, small awakenings, the difference between self and no self is vastly clear. It's like the difference between having a window and then no window at all, right? And the window may be clean, those people that spick and span, you know, clean window, clear. But the window is still there, right? So people that haven't experienced awakening, they can't tell the difference. But for people who have, the difference is night and day. It's not even comparable. No windows versus window. Something is there. So the sense of self, when it manifests, it's like a prick. It's like a thorn. So for the past year, studying, reading a lot about politics. Usually, practitioners not really into that, but I have to adapt to the circumstances, right? Politics, and discriminatory policies, and cultural theorists who analyze America, right? So on, different political parties and so on. So however astute, clear their analysis, however articulate they are, some of them are very articulate, penetrating their insights. The sense of positionality and the agenda, it's like a thorn. Most people are just convinced by the clarity of their, discourse. They just kind of buy into it. But for practitioners, whenever we encounter people with sense of self, it's so clear, right? So it's very hard for the bodhisattva practitioner to actually buy into the rhetoric. However clear the rhetoric is, insightful it is. So it's very hard for practitioners to take sides, Now, on a conventional reality, the workings of causes and conditions of this moment, bodhisattva practitioners take sides, because we need to amplify those who are underprivileged, those who are discriminated against. It is the causes and conditions. But within their heart, anytime the spike comes out, or the spike is felt, method, practice. What practice? Animita, alakshana, formlessness. Whatever positionality are proposed, formlessness. So bring it back, ground oneself in selfless, formless, non-abiding, and engage. Utilize the insights of these cultural theorists or whoever. Utilize the insights and without the agenda, without the self-attachment there. And engage with the world. The foundation of which is connection. This connection is compassion. But it is only compassion when it is grounded in selfless wisdom. When agenda are present, positionalities are strong, there is no compassion. There is no betterment of humanity. There is suffering. Because whatever action that we take is infused by that. Grasping us versus them. So, now we come to We talked about self. We talked about healthy self, strong. We talked about big self. Next is bodhicitta. That's the fusion of selfless wisdom and non-oppositional compassion. So in this, there's no vexations. That's the wisdom part. Kleshas. Now, of course, we can't bring ourselves to the state of completely free from vexations, right? But that's our cultivation. That's the practice. We're not full Buddhas yet, but that's the practice. No vexations. Second quality, no enemies. That's the compassion part. So wisdom has no vexations. Compassion has no enemy. That's the litmus test of bodhicitta in engaging with the world. So, you know, we may be working for the humanity, for the betterment of society, for social justice, for equality. Do you see enemies? Are there enemies in your heart? It's very difficult. So we have to remind ourselves, who is it that's perpetrating? Who is it that are the victims? What is the self? Amidst all these forms, appearances, they are just causes and conditions, positionality, lessness, merging, coming together, and separating. And ground ourselves. So we'll be able to adjust and attune that enemy that we feel, the injustice that we feel, right? The wrongs that we feel. We have to adjust it. If your body is tense, you will not be able to access it. The defense mechanism is up. You're ready to fight, right? So you have to diffuse it and then can access it, grounding, connecting with ourselves, connecting with our heart, and then adjust, release that tension, the enemy. Everyone is trying their best. Everyone has a story. Their actions may be controlled by their vexations. What we see is just the person, these perpetrators, but actually the reality is they're not in charge. It's the vexations that's the big boss, that's the big honcho, governing every action, every speech, every thought. It's very pitiable. So our action is to recognize the workings of causes and conditions, learning to work with them. and recognizing that all beings, originally, without vexations, without enemies, that is the merit of wisdom and compassion is complete. But because of delusion, they can't help themselves. That's suffering. And we recognize that within us too. Right? The first person, us, the enemy that we feel. Release and engage. So bodhicitta, not grounding our practice for our own benefit, for our own salvation, for our own awakening. No. The more we practice, the more we actually connected with our body and mind, heart. The more connected we are, the more we recognize how connected we are with everything. And moving beyond connected to our peers, those people who are close to us, who align with us, we're actually connected to everyone indiscriminately. And recognizing that this freedom, this connection, is within everyone's reach. But the suffering, the causes, mechanism of suffering is continually perpetuated. And the only way to bring all out of this vortex is to work for the benefit of all, but without attachment to form, to a sense of what is form? Me, I, mine, others, humanity. I'm working for humanity. Sentient beings, that's the Buddhist language, sentient beings, right? But colloquially, humanity, all living creatures. The earth, all living things. Without that, without attachment to that form. And without a sense of accomplishment, which happens in time. This is expounded. All of what I'm saying is expounded. I'm just putting it in kind of an experiential way, colloquially, but all expounded in the Prajnaparamita scriptures, the foundation of Mahayana. So the form, they call it, absence of the four forms, like the Diamond Sutra, for example. Yeah. Self, others, sentient beings, time, or duration. So, formless. What is it that's a perpetrator? Who is it that's a victim? Sometimes the victims are perpetrators. Sometimes the perpetrators, definitely perpetrators, are victims. They're suffering. Who's who? Despite that formlessness, there's actions. People are getting hurt. So we engage in helping. And that the more deeper we engage in our practice, the more connected we are, the more grounded we are, the more these lofty teachings in the Prajnaparamita, perfection of wisdom, becomes grounded in your experience. And that becomes the only way to be free, to bring justice, to bring peace, is to work together without attachment, without enemies. And that becomes the driving fuel of our practice, of Chan practice. Now, that doesn't mean the congruent wholesome self vanished. No, that's still there. Right? That doesn't mean the sense of connection, it's not there. It's still there. Everything's there. All the foundation of practice is all there. So the self is congruent. There's integrity, virtue, and there's connection. There's interconnection. And the only way to move out of there is to recognize formlessness, selflessness. That is bodhicitta, Bodhi mind. Bodhi mind is something intrinsic in all beings. All beings, we just need to bring it out. So for that reason, it's also called, in the Mahayana tradition, in the Chan Zen tradition, it's also called the beginner's mind. So this beginner's mind, in the context of the Mahayana tradition, of the Chan Zen tradition, Song tradition, the beginner's mind refers to Bodhi mind. Right? It's grounded in connection, compassion. And the connections is precisely emptiness, no self. It's just another way of saying dependent origination, causes and conditions, right? Selflessness or emptiness. Another way of saying that just means connections. So in this, the wisdom of emptiness, connection, there is compassion there already. So, on this occasion, I'd like to share with you Bodhi mind, the importance of Bodhi mind.